So this is the fifth talk on urinary system. This deals with the tubular reabsorption at the proximal convoluted tubule. As the beginning, I will explain the different sites of the cells through which the reabsorption happens from the proximal convoluted tubule. So this is the cross-section of proximal convoluted tubule. This is a cross-section of peritubular capillary lumen. So the proximal convoluted tubule, the wall is made up of a single layer of epithelial cells. So this layer of epithelial cells at different part of the renal tubule is having different types of peculiarities. In the proximal convoluted tubule, the side of the cell facing the tubule has microvilli. So that side is called brush border or apical border of the cells, through which reabsorption from that fluid happens. And the other three sides, just opposite side, that's the side facing the capillary, is called the basal side. And the other two sides are called lateral side. So, apical side or brush border, basal side, lateral side. So, all these sides, there are different types of transporters which help in the reabsorption of materials from the tubular fluid and their movement from the cell to the interstitial space. So, these cells are quite specialized, and we will see the specialization in detail in the coming slides. So the proximal convoluted tubule has got, or it is the area of major reabsorption in the nephron. 2/3 of water, sodium, chloride, etc. reabsorbed at this place. And also almost all the organic materials like glucose and amino acids are absorbed here. And also this area plays a major part in the acid-base balance, acid-base control of the body system. So this is the proximal convoluted tubule part of the nephron. So, and also among this area, the early part of the proximal convoluted tubule is slightly different from the distal part of the proximal convoluted tubule that we will see in the next slide. So this is the adaptation. This diagram shows the adaptation of the epithelial cells of the proximal convoluted tubule. So the side of the cell facing the tubular lumen has got a number of microvilli. You know that the microvilli, you have seen another area where microvilli are present, that is in the small intestine. So this, there you have seen that this microvilli increases the surface area. So there is a large surface area for reabsorption. So this increases its capacity for reabsorption. And also most of the reabsorption happens, mainly the sodium reabsorption and related co-transport of some glucose, amino acid, hydrogen, etc. happens by active transport. The active transport needs enormous amount of energy. This amount of energy is provided by ATP, which is produced in the mitochondria. As a result, these cells have a lot of mitochondria. So the brush border, the large number of mitochondria, and also various transporters at the different sites, the basolateral side as well as the brush border. These are the peculiarities or adaptations of these cells for high rate of reabsorption. So what is happening at the, what type of reabsorption happens at the early part of the proximal convoluted tubule? So the basolateral transporter Na plus K plus ATPase plays a major role in the reabsorption that is happening in the proximal convoluted tubule. So sodium is moved from the cell cytoplasm to the interstitial fluid. That is the space between the fluid in the space between the capillary and the tubule. So sodium is moved by active transport using Na plus K plus ATPase or Na plus glucose or amino acid transporters. So this is an active transport where ATP is used. When sodium is moving out, glucose or amino acids are also moved out. So this is a sink water. All the movement is happening to a single site. So here there is another transporter that is also driven by Na plus movement. This is also an active transport. Here organic substances are moving along with the sodium. So these are co-transporters, or they are symporters. Then here on the other side, that is a brush border, transporters are there. Here also it is sodium along with the sodium. So when sodium is moving into the cell, glucose and amino acids are also moving with us. So co-transporter, this is a symporter, this is sodium and our organic solutes. In addition to this, antiporters are there. Na plus K plus antiporter. When sodium is moving from the cell into the interstitial fluid, potassium is moving from the interstitial fluid into the cell cytoplasm. Here also, when sodium is moving into the cell, hydrogen ions are moving out of the cells into the fluid. That is high secretion of hydrogen. They are antiporters. The ions or substances are moving in opposite directions. And in the proximal convoluted tubule, a lot of water is reabsorbed. This reabsorption happens by osmosis. The sodium is reabsorbed, glucose is reabsorbed, amino acids are reabsorbed, chloride ions are reabsorbed. So many reabsorption happens. As a result, the concentration of the tubular fluid decreases, or the concentration of water in the tubular fluid increases. As a result, water moved by osmosis from the tubular fluid into the cell and then into the interstitial fluid by transcellular movement or through the intercellular space, through the tight tension by paracellular route. The tight tension here is highly permeable to water. As a result, water moves by osmosis. So this is the reabsorption of sodium, glucose, amino acid and water at the early part of the proximal convoluted tube. When we see the distal part of the proximal convoluted tubule, almost all have the movement happening in the early part of the distal convoluted tubule also happens at the late part of the proximal convoluted tubule. So the here is Na plus K plus ATPase, Na plus H plus transporter. Here sodium is moving in, hydrogen is moving out. So it is an antiporter. This is also an antiporter. In addition to the movement happening here at the early part of proximal convoluted tubule, the distal part of the convoluted tubule, there is movement of sodium, chloride, water, etc. through paracellular route. Here what happens is, a lot of water is absorbed by osmosis at the early part. As a result, the concentration of sodium and chloride increases. When sodium is moving, because the concentration of sodium is high here, than sodium here, that is the interstitial fluid. Sodium is moving because of this electrochemical gradient from a higher concentration to a lower concentration. Then what happens? Water also moves by osmosis. Then the movement of water and sodium increases the concentration of chloride ions in the tubular fluid. As a result, electrochemical gradient, concentration gradient of chloride ions, as a result, chloride ions from there higher concentration move to the area of lower concentration, that is the interstitial fluid. So chloride ions movement, that is by concentration gradient. Then also the chloride ions are dissolved in water. Water acts as a solvent. So when the water solvent is moving, this solvent will drag chloride ions to the interstitial fluid. So chloride ions are by two processes, moving by two processes. One is the concentration gradient as well as be dragged by the solvent. So this is the reabsorption happening at the late part of proximal convoluted tubule. So there are a lot of reabsorption through paracellular route. Then, so these materials reach the interstitial space. That is the space between the tubular epithelial cells and the capillaries. It's there here. So from here, these materials move into the capillaries by bulk transport, bulk ultrafiltration. It is almost similar process that is happening at the glomerulus, the Bowman's capsule. Though this filtration is, or this movement is non-specific. So whatever is reaching here from the tubular fluid is moving by bulk transport into the peritubular capillaries, and the movement is controlled or affected by mainly three forces. One is the colloidal osmotic pressure in the capillaries. You know that this blood in this capillary is coming from the glomerulus. This is a continuation of the efferent arteriole. So the nature of the blood here is there is a lot of protein molecules, less amount of water. This causes the colloidal osmotic pressure high and also the less amount of water, hydrostatic pressure is low. And also various physical forces around this, the concentration differences like that. That all these factors push the materials into the capillaries by bulk ultrafiltration. The sodium transport is by gradient time transport principle. So you know that sodium transport is by active transport. Normally, in the case of an active transport, there is a transport maximum for the material. That is, there is an amount, the maximum amount which can be absorbed by the tubules. But in the case of sodium, the absorption is not controlled by transport maximum, because the absorption or reabsorption of sodium is affected by many factors in addition to its concentration. The concentration is one factor, there is no doubt in that, because the epithelial cell sodium concentration is 11 milliequivalents, whereas in the tubular fluid it is 140 milliequivalents. So there is a huge concentration gradient. So that makes the sodium to move through the transporters. In addition to that, the charge of the cells, cytoplasm, is minus 70 millivolts. So the positive ions will move into the cells. So these two factors, one is concentration, the other is charge. So an additional factor other than charge. In addition to this, in the tube there is little bit of sodium leak into the tubular lumen. So from the interstitial space, sodium is moved into the tubular lumen through the paracellular route. So this also affects the sodium reabsorption. So in addition to concentration difference. Because of these factors, so sodium reabsorption follows or obeys gradient time transport principle, like a passive transport. Then the reabsorption of organic solutes and phosphate. Organic solutes include so glucose, amino acids, etc. So they are through specific symporters. Symporters, the movement of materials are in the same direction. So sodium and glucose are moving in the same direction. Sodium and amino acids are moving in the same direction. So this is another symporter. So there's many different types of symporters. These are molecularly linked to sodium reabsorption. So sodium reabsorption is an important factor that controls the reabsorption process in the proximal convoluted tubule. And all these organic solutes are reabsorbed by secondary active transport mechanism. So the active transport mechanism, as we have seen in the previous lecture, there are two types of active transport mechanism in the kidney tubules, that is primary active transport mechanism and the secondary active transport mechanism. In the primary active transport mechanism, for example, in the transport of sodium, Na plus is moving into the cell or moving from the cell into the outside of the cell. It is driven by the energy from ATP molecule. Energy is needed for this transport. ATP is utilized, ATP is converted into ADP, and energy released will be used here. So that is directly using of energy from ATP, that is the primary active transport. When the sodium is moving in, along with that glucose moves in, co-transporter of glucose, co-transporter of amino acids. So for the transport of this glucose or amino acids, there is no direct use of energy. But without the sodium transport, these two transport cannot take place. And the sodium transport is taking place by using energy, that is primary active transport. That primary active transport drives the movement of this glucose and amino acids. So indirect use of energy. So it is called secondary and active transport. So the movement of organic materials are by secondary active transport and affected by the sodium electrochemical gradient. And this reabsorption is very efficient. Because of that, almost all glucose as well as amino acids are reabsorbed. So very efficient mechanism. And the transporters involved, here you can see here SGLT transporters. There are two types of SGLT transporters, SGLT1 and SGLT2. SGLT2 is present at the early part of the proximal convoluted tubule at the basal site. and SGLT1 is present at the late part of proximal convoluted tubule, the basal side of the proximal convoluted tubule. This SGLT1 and SGLT2 makes glucose co-transported along with sodium from the tubular lumen to the cell. From the cell to the interstitial fluid, the movement is through GLUT transformase, GLUT2 and GLUT1 transporters. GLUT2 transporter is present at the early part of proximal convoluted tubule. GLUT1 is present at the late part of the proximal convoluted tubule. These are the two types of transporters, SGLT2, SGLT1. SGLT2, which is seen at the early part, it reabsorbs 90% of the glucose. The SGLT1, which is present at the late part of proximal convoluted tubule, contribute 10% of the reabsorption. And similarly, GLUT2, at the initial part, the movement of glucose from the cell into the interstitial space. GLUT1 at the later part. So those are the four transporters used in the transport of glucose from the tubular fluid to the interstitial space. And this is driven by the movement of sodium. And also one more transport is affected by this, or controlled by this, or driven by sodium transport, that is the sodium hydrogen exchanger. When sodium is moving out of the cell, what happens is this hydrogen is, or more sodium is moving from the tubular fluid into the cell. Hydrogen is secreted from the cell into the tubular fluid. So this is antipotensial. The ions are moving in opposite direction. Then water reabsorption. So far, glucose is absorbed, amino acids are absorbed, sodium is reabsorbed. So all this reabsorption changes the concentration of the fluid in the tubular lumen. The concentration increases. Concentration of water increases. Lot of water, less amount of solute. As a result, the concentration of water is high in the tubular fluid compared to the cell or the interstitial fluid. This makes the water move by osmosis into the interstitial fluid, and it takes two routes, two causes. One is transcellular, passes through the cell. Second is paracellular, that is through the space between the cells. So these two routes are adopted by water, and the movement is by osmosis. And even though this water and sodium are reabsorbed from the tubular fluid, the concentration of sodium and water is not changing in the fluid, because they are reabsorbed in the same proportion. So concentration is not changing. Then reabsorption of chloride, calcium, magnesium, phosphorus, etc. These are quite important in the body metabolism. Their abnormalities or their imbalance of these materials will cause various troubles in your body, like arrhythmias, seizures, and respiratory difficulties. Muscular contraction will be affected. The nerve transport will be affected when calcium is lesser or chloride is lesser. So their reabsorption is quite important. Almost all these materials which are filtered at the glomerulus are reabsorbed while this fluid is moving through the nephron, different parts of the nephron. And the kidney, as a result, kidney play a major role in their control. So their reabsorption involves a number of channels, number of transporters, and pathways are involved. So we'll see one by one. So the chloride reabsorption. The reabsorption of chloride at the early part of the proximal convoluted tubule is very limited, almost nil. But at this point, a lot of water is reabsorbed. Sodium is reabsorbed. Glucose is reabsorbed. Amino acids are reabsorbed. As a result, what happens is the concentration of the proportional concentration of chloride is quite high there. At the same time, the concentration of chloride in the interstitial fluid is low. This makes the chloride ions move from the tubular fluid to the interstitial space by osmosis, or from a higher concentration to a lower concentration. We cannot say it osmosis, it is from a diffusion, chloro high concentration to lower concentration through the paracellular route. And also, in the, as we have seen in the previous slide, this, when the water is moving, the water drags, it is a solvent, the solvent drag, the water drags chloride ions into the distillation fluid. So the concentration gradient as well as solvent drag causes the movement of chloride ions from the tubular fluid to the interstitial fluid. And the passive diffusion and solvent drag through a paracellular route, and there is no reabsorption at the early part of the proximal convoluted tubule. The reabsorption is at the late part of the proximal convoluted tubule. Then calcium reabsorption. You know that calcium is quite important for our body. It is needed for muscular contraction, nerve impulse transport, for the synthesis of different types of hormones, for intercellular attraction, for everything, that blood coagulation, calcium is needed. So calcium reabsorption is quite important, and it parallels that of sodium and water, like in the case of chloride ions. It is reabsorbed parallel to the reabsorption of sodium and water, and mainly passive diffusion and solvent drag, same as in the case of chloride ions. Because as the fluid moves through the tubule, the concentration of calcium is increasing because other materials are reabsorbed, and the concentration is higher than in the interstitial fluid. So it moves by passive movement, and the water movement also drags this calcium, that is the solvent drag. 80% of the calcium reabsorption is by passive movement through paracellular route, and 10 to 15% of the calcium reabsorption is by active transport. So 80% removed or moved by, because of the concentration gradient as well as solvent drag. Then sometimes more calcium need to be reabsorbed, the body calcium storage is quite low, then the active transport come into play. Because of that, this active transport control the calcium reabsorption level from the tubular fluid into the body. So, and this is controlled by two hormones, parathyroid hormone and calcitonin. So the different part of the tubule has different rate of reabsorption. The proximal convoluted tubule reabsorbs 60 to 70%, and the reabsorption way paracellular method. There is no reabsorption at the descending loop of Henle and ascending part of the thin loop of Henle. But the ascending thick loop of Henle reabsorbs 20% by paracellular transport. But the picture changes when it comes to the distal convoluted tubule. The reabsorption is through transcellular route, that is active transport mainly, and that is around 10% of the reabsorption, and the collecting tubule around 5% of reabsorption happens there. So almost all the calcium is reabsorbed. Reabsorption of phosphate. So glomerulus, that is around 3700 to 6100 milligrams of phosphate is filtered in a day at the Bowman's capsule in both the kidneys together. But the net excretion is only 600 to 1500 milligrams of phosphate in a day. The rest of it is reabsorbed. So 75 to 80% of daily filtered load is reabsorbed by the renal tubules. So only less than 15 to 25% is excreted. Out of this 70 to 85% reabsorption, major part of the reabsorption, that is 85%, is at the proximal convoluted tubule. So that is another important role of proximal convoluted tubule. Major part of phosphate reabsorption is taking place at the proximal convoluted tubule. That is 85% of the filtered phosphate is reabsorbed here. Here there are specific transporters for this reabsorption. There are three types of transporters. They are NBT2A, NBT2Z and PIT2. These transporters on the apical border control the reabsorption, and this is also a secondary active transport because it is driven by sodium movement, sodium dependent phosphate transporter, that is NBT. Depends on the abundance of transporters. So if the body needs to reabsorb more phosphate, the number of these transporters on the apical side increases. And if the body's reabsorption need to be decreased, the number of transporters on this apical side is decreasing. So the number of transporters decide how much phosphate is reabsorbed. So this is how the transporters work. So NBT2A, phosphate is reabsorbed along with the sodium is reabsorbed. So it is electrogenic. Why is it, or how is it? You can see here two negative ions, two negative charge. Then sodium, three sodium ions are reabsorbed. That is three positive charge. So one positive charge extra reabsorbed. That is electrogenic. So the side become more positive. Here in this case, PIT2, one phosphate, both with two negative charges. So there is no positive charge reabsorption. So as a result, the inside charge is increased by four negative charges. So it is electrogenic. Here, NBT2Z, two sodium ions are reabsorbed, one phosphate ion with two negative charge reabsorbed. Two positive, two negative. So they are neutralized. So electro neutral. So these causes the movement of phosphate ions into the cell. Once inside the cell, it is transported into the interstitial fluid by certain transporters, but we don't know which transporters are doing this transport. Unknown transporter. Studies are still going on. So reabsorption of phosphate at different parts of the renal tubule. 80% reabsorption at the proximal convoluted tubule. Then 10% by the thick limb of ascending loop of LA. The 3% at the distal convoluted tubule and only 2% at the collecting tubule. Major reabsorption at the proximal convoluted tubule using transportase. Then magnesium reabsorption. Magnesium is the second most abundant divalent cation in the body. The first one is calcium, Ca2+. Mg2+ is the second abundant, and this is quite important in body function. The contraction of heart muscles, because your blood pressure depends quite on the magnesium ions present in your body. So if the magnesium concentration is low, there is a chance of high BP. So magnesium is quite important. And in the functioning of different enzymes, it is needed. So it's quite important to reabsorb magnesium. Approximately 2400 milligram of magnesium is filtered into the Bowman's capsule. So it's comparatively lesser compared to other ions like calcium or chloride ions. Why? Because 30% of the body's magnesium remains attached to the proteins. So only 70% is free. So out of that 70%, the filtration happens. So 30% they are immobilized by attached with the proteins. Only 70% of the total magnesium is available for filtration. And here, only 10-30% of magnesium, the filtered magnesium, is reabsorbed at the proximal convoluted tubule. So this is the only substance which is reabsorbed at a lower rate at the proximal convoluted tubule. Rest of it will be reabsorbed at the later part of the nephron. And here the mechanism is not well known. Several transporters, coordinated transport mechanisms and magnesium transporters are suspected. We don't know it yet. So the studies are going on. So this is also reabsorbed by depending upon the sodium gradient and also by the water movement. Water, the magnesium salts, which most of them are soluble in water, and when the water is moving, the solvent will drag this magnesium along with that. So the magnesium, the solvent drag, as well as sodium gradient, and the different transporters are suspected to be involved. So the magnesium reabsorption at different parts of the nephron. 10-30% at the proximal convoluted tubule, 70% at the thick limb of ascending loop of LA, 10% at the distal convoluted tubule. So almost all the magnesium is reabsorbed. Protein reabsorption. Protein reabsorption, generally protein is not filtered into the glomerulus. from the glomerulus into the Bowman's capsule. But sometimes, maybe due to certain abnormalities or some other physical conditions, proteins get filtered. Most of this protein will be reabsorbed. And how is this happening? This is happening by pyknocytosis. And you all know what is pyknocytosis. Pyknocytosis is the movement of solid particles, the bulk movement of solid particles into the cell. And this is also an active transport. Energy is needed for this. So, protein comes into contact with the brush border of this epithelial cell. At the place of protein contact, the plasma membrane invaginates, holding the protein. So, the protein is in the invagination and the protein, the invagination pinches off. The protein pinches off with the protein, that invagination pinches off, holding the protein, and a vesicle is formed. The protein is in the vesicle, it moves, fuses with lysosome, and the protein gets digested. And when you know what is produced when protein is digested, amino acids are released. These amino acids are reabsorbed by a mechanism driven by sodium reabsorption. The movement of sodium from the cell to the interstitial space by the transporters, energy independent transport. Sodium is transported by primary active transport. Because of the movement of the sodium, these amino acids are dragged to the interstitial space, that is secondary active transport of amino acids from the cell into the interstitial space. From there, bulk transport into the peritubular capillary. So this is how proteins are reabsorbed. Reabsorption of urea. You know that urea is a waste material. Its reabsorption need to be controlled. But at the same time, reabsorption of certain amount of urea becomes inevitable, because as the tubule, the fluid is passing through the tubule, the concentration changes. The concentration of urea is quite high, so part of it will move through the transporters into the cell, and from there through the transporters into the interstitial fluid. 50% of the filtered urea is reabsorbed. And because of this electrochemical gradient between the luminal fluid and the epithelial cells, so that there is more urea in the tubular fluid, less urea in the cell. So the gradient that causes the movement of urea through urea transporters. 50% of the urea is reabsorbed. Then bicarbonate excretion. The reabsorption of bicarbonate is quite important because it controls the acid-base balance of the body. If more bicarbonate is secreted or excreted through urine, the acidosis will happen. The body becomes acidic in nature, the body fluids. So this is not good because our enzymes will not work in acidic pH, most of the enzymes, except some of the digestive enzymes. So reabsorption of bicarbonate is very important, and most of the bicarbonate is reabsorbed. But unfortunately, the bicarbonate cannot enter into the cell, or it cannot pass through the intercellular space. Because of that, it should be converted into carbon dioxide. Bicarbonate combines with hydrogen, secreted by sodium, hydrogen, and the water, or through the H plus ATPase proton pump. Two mechanisms for the secretion of hydrogen into the tubular fluid from the cell. That is sodium dependent transport. When one sodium atom ion is moving into the cell, one H plus ion is moving out. Antiporter, 1-to-1 antiporter. So then this H plus ATPase proton pump, if the proton pump is pumping the H plus out, both these are active transport mechanisms. Here, primary active transport, here it is secondary, because the sodium, the LG is used for the transport of sodium. That drives the movement of H+. So it is secondary active transport. So this is, even though it is secondary, this is the major secretory mechanism for hydrogen compared to this H+ ATPase proton pump. And also, this transporters, here see, that I will say later. So hydrogen is secreted into the tubular fluid. This hydrogen combines with bicarbonate ion, HCO3 minus ion, forming H2CO3, that is carbonic acid. This carbonic acid, in presence of carbonic anhydrase enzyme, splits into water and carbon dioxide. So water can move in by osmosis. Carbon dioxide, this is lipid soluble. So it can pass through the lipids in the plasma membrane and reach the end of the cell. So carbon dioxide and water enter the cell. In presence of the same enzyme, carbonic anhydride, because it is a reversible reaction, it is combined and carbonic acid is formed. Here, carbonic acid is placed, but it is not forming water and carbon dioxide. It forms H plus ions and HCO3 ions, bicarbonate ion. This bicarbonate ion is moved to the interstitial space through a sodium dependent movement. So this Na plus HCO3. So one Na plus ion moves, then three HCO3 ions are moving, HCO3 minus ion. So 1 plus 3 minus. So it is electrogenic, more minus charges into the interstitial fluid. And then, so this H plus ions which will move into the tubular space, tubular lumen. So H plus ion went inside, one H plus ion, one H plus ion came out. So there is net movement of H plus ions is zero. There is no net movement of H plus ions. And for each H plus ion secreted, one HCO3 ion is reabsorbed. So the sodium enters inside, three sodium goes out, three ion, 30 sodium ions, when two potassium ions are entering. So this is also 3 minus 2, 1 positive ion towards the sodium side, that is the interstitial fluid side, that is electrogenic. This is electrogenic, this is electrogenic. This is also sodium in opposite direction, antiporter, symporter or co-transport. So no net excretion of S plus ion. S plus ion secreted, the same goes in, but in different form as water. So this is the bicarbonate excretion. So 4000 to 5000 millimoles of bicarbonate is filtered daily. Most of it is reabsorbed. So how is this filtration? 1 liter of plasma contain 24 millimoles of bicarbonate. And you know that in a day 180 liters of tubular, the glomerular filtrate is produced. So each liter contain 24 millimoles. So 180 into 24 millimoles, that is 4320 millimoles of filtration daily, between 4000 to 5000 millimoles. 85 to 90% of the filtered bicarbonate is reabsorbed at the proximal tubule. So 4000 to 5000 millimoles is filtered, out of that 85 to 90% is reabsorbed at the proximal convoluted tubule by the mechanism which we have seen in the previous slide. Rest is reabsorbed by the intercalated cells of distal convoluted tubule and collecting tubule that we will discuss when we are discussing about the reabsorption of those areas. The major factors controlling bicarbonate reabsorption, because different factors control its reabsorption, because the reabsorption is quite important, because this decides the acidity or basicity of the body fluids or cellular fluids. So increase in any of these will increase bicarbonate reabsorption. For example, when luminal HCO3 ions are increasing, automatically it will increase bicarbonate reabsorption, because more carbon dioxide is produced and those carbon dioxide enter into the cell and bicarbonate is reabsorbed. Then luminal flow rate, you can see how luminal flow rate is going to affect the bicarbonate reabsorption. Because when the fluid is moving faster, what happens? There is less time for reabsorption. So less reabsorption. When the fluid is moving slowly, more time for reabsorption, more is reabsorbed. Because this bicarbonate need to be converted into carbonic acid and then into carbon dioxide and water. This conversion is quite fast, because the carbonic anhydrase enzyme is quite fast. It's one of the fastest enzymes in our body. Then arterial partial pressure of carbon dioxide. If the partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the arteries is high, what happens? More CO2 will be filtered into the Bowman's capsule. More CO2 in the Bowman's capsule means this CO2 plus the CO2 formed from the bicarbonate. There is more CO2 is there, and there is a competition between these two. So that causes less reabsorption of bicarbonate. then angiotensin 2. This is an indirect mechanism. This affects the bicarbonate reabsorption indirectly because it affects the production of cyclic AMP. Angiotensin 2 decreases the production of cyclic AMP, and when cyclic AMP production is low, more bicarbonate is reabsorbed. But there is another hormone, the parathyroid hormone. It increases the production of cyclic AMP. So as a result, when there is more cyclic AMP, less bicarbonate reabsorption. So when parathyroid hormone is higher, less amount of bicarbonate will be reabsorbed. So here, along with the bicarbonate reabsorption, S plus secretion is happening. This S plus secretion is high capacity secretion because large quantity of hydrogen ions are secreted, but it is of low gradient system. Low gradient means when S plus is moving, it affects the acidity. But even though a large quantity of S plus is secreted into the tubular fluid, the pH changes to a minimum from 7.4 to 7 or 6.7. So very slight change in the pH. So that is why it is called a low gradient system, low pH gradient change. But high quantity is also high capacity, low gradient system, S plus secretion. Organic ions. There are different organic ions are reabsorbed. Cations and anions are reabsorbed. Variety of transporters. It can be absorption, reabsorption or secretion. So I am just going to say one reabsorption, that is the citrate reabsorption by one transporter called sodium dependent dicarboxylic acid co-transporter, NADZ1. It is a sodium dependent transporter. So this NADCA1, it is present on the brush border, that is the border facing the lumen of the tubule. So it is a sodium dependent transport. Sodium is transported in active transport along with citrate is taken in. So secondary active transport. This one citrate is inside the cell, it has two fate. Citrate is converted into oxaloacetate and acetyl coenzyme, and later they will be used in the metabolism. Second thing, the citrate enters into the mitochondria and it will become part of the citric acid cycle, and the citrate is converted into carbon dioxide and water. So this is one example of organic ion reabsorption using transporter. Similarly, for each organic ion transporter, reabsorbed or secreted, it has its own particular transporter. So secretion of organic acids and bases. These are generally waste products of our metabolism, like bile salts, oxalate, urate, catecholamines. They are secreted into the proximal convoluted tubule. Along with the secretion, already they were filtered at the Bowman's capsule. So that filtration at the Bowman's capsule and the secretion at the proximal convoluted tubule, these two will help in the speedy removal from the blood, because they are waste products, they need to be removed immediately. So these two processes. Filtration of the glomerulus or at the Bowman's capsule and the secretion of the proximal convoluted tubule, and major part of it will be removed. And also at the proximal convoluted tubule or in any part of the tubule, they will not be reabsorbed. So they will be excreted. And along with that, many toxins are also secreted. Depending upon what toxin is present in the blood, they will be secreted into the lumina fluid and it will not be reabsorbed. And another problem with the secretion is drugs like penicillin and salicylates, etc., will also be secreted. Actually, this is acting against our will because we wanted those drugs in our body for a longer period of time. But unfortunately, in the kidney tubule, they are secreted into the lumen of the tubule and it will be excreted. Because of that, to keep the therapeutic level, because they should be present in the body at a certain level for their action. So if that is not present in that level, they will be useless. So we have to keep on consuming those drugs. So the secretion is acting against our will there. So it is secreted. So this picture diagram summarizes what is happening at the proximal convoluted tubule, reabsorption and the secretion. So you can see Na plus Cl minus and H2O, 2/3 of it is reabsorbed. Urea, 50% is reabsorbed. glucose amino acids, almost all the glucose and amino acids, very highly efficient reabsorption mechanism. Bicarbonate, 85 to 90% is reabsorbed. CH2 plus, 60 to 70% reabsorbed at the proximal convoluted tubule. Magnesium, only 10 to 30% reabsorbed. Protein, almost all the protein is reabsorbed as amino acids. Organic cations and anions, they are also reabsorbed. Then phosphates, 65%, more than 65% is reabsorbed. Then secretion, metabolic waste is secreted to remove the waste material. Toxins are secreted. Organic acids and bases are secreted. They are mainly the waste products of our metabolism. And drugs like penicillin is also secreted, which is unwanted secretion. But because of the kidney mechanism, they are secreted. So from this you can see that proximal convoluted tubule plays a major part in the kidney's function by reabsorbing the wanted materials and excluding or secreting the unwanted materials in the tubular fluid. Thank you.